Miss Sadie's Divining Parlor.
Page 51.
May 29th, 1936. Haven't gone back in time recently.
We have not. All the action's happening during the Great Depression.
After tossing and turning most of the night, I imagine I looked a bit puny the next morning. Shady gave me a sideways look as he doled out a hot bowl of cream of wheat.
Yum.
At the far end of the bar. Okay, cream of wheat is not a today thing, but I know you like it. Can you explain it?
I love cream of wheat. And you put like a little shallow little bit of sugar on top and melt a little bit of butter and tiny, tiny bit of cream. Oh.
But it's kind of like oatmeal, but not.
Yeah, it's made of wheat, not oat.
Right, but so it's like oatmeal, but it's made with wheat, not oats.
Yes, but it's really good, guaranteed. And it's warm, so it's good in the wintertime. With that sugar on top and a little bit of butter and a tiny bit of cream.
Maybe we'll have to try some at school.
Oh, it's good.
Okay, remind me.
And if you don't like it, that's your problem.
All right. I skimmed off a spoonful and blew on it, waiting for it to cool. I glanced behind him and noticed a bottle of amber liquid tucked up on a shelf. Having been raised around men who were down on their luck, I was no stranger to the sight of alcohol. There was only the one bottle and it was full. I guessed it made sense to have a little hooch in a saloon, even if it was part church. What's hooch?
Hooch is liquor.
That you're not supposed to have, right?
No, you could have it in 1936. But I think the point is, Shady didn't have much in his saloon.
But
apparently
he had
one bottle
of liquor.
Yeah.
You had a couple callers yesterday. Did they find you in the treehouse? Oh, Letty and Ruth Ann? I tried to sound casual. Yes, they stopped to visit a while. I didn't think he'd take too kindly to the nighttime activities. And judging from Ruth Ann's and Letty's talk, I figured their folks would be even less receptive. Let's see, they're cousins. They'd be... Oh, that's you.
Oh, this is me. Right. Sorry.
Shady.
Shady. Right. Let's see, they're cousins. They'd be Nora's and Betty's girls, those Wallace girls their mothers used to get into all kinds of mischief when they were young. I guess they're getting their comeuppances now.
Paying for their raisin.
Yeah.
Shady said with a grin. I wondered if he knew about the mischief that had gone on the night before.
Well, there's an old shed that's fallen down behind the McGregor place. I'm going over to gather up some of the scrap wood. You're welcome to come along.
Thank you, but I'll stay here and clean up the breakfast dishes. Gideon says I'm supposed to be a help. Not a burden.
Never you mind about that, but all right then, I'll be back around noon. We're having church service here tonight, followed by a potluck dinner. Be sure to invite your friends and tell them we'd be pleased to have them.
It was flattering, but Shady was highly overestimating my circle of friends. It looks... go ahead.
Says me again. Mm-hmm. Well, it looks like it's going to be a hot one today. Remember, this is 1936, and it was absolutely hot.
Putting on a hat that seemed to have long ago lost its shape, he stepped outside and peered into the cloudless sky. He lifted the handles of a wheelbarrow and started off. Sorry, I'm yawning. That put an idea into my head, and I mulled it over while washing the dishes and wiping down the bar top. If he was trying to get his outside chores done early, maybe that Miss Sadie would be doing the same and wouldn't come back till noon. This was my chance to get my compass back without risking loss of limb or soul. My rag caught on a crack in the bar top. At first, I thought it was just a split in the wood, but looking closer, I could see that the top of the bar was a movable panel. I pulled on it, and with hardly any effort, the whole section moved forward and then down, another panel taking its place on the top like the first one had never been there. My washcloth had disappeared underneath without a trace. So... during the time that alcohol was illegal.
In the 1920s.
They would have speakeasies where people could go, and if you knew the certain password, you could get in. And they would serve alcohol there. And they would have a bar like this with a fake top on it, so that if the police were coming and they were going to be found out, they could hide the alcohol and say, we don't have any alcohol.
Have you seen the alcohol? I haven't seen the alcohol. Ew, no alcohol.
No alcohol here, but it was a fake bar top. Mm. And it would go down underneath.
What's the password?
I don't know.
Well, if you know, make sure she knows.
All right. Well, the word speakeasy sprung to mind. I can tell you. Those are the places all over the country where folks sell and drink bootlegged alcohol and hope to not get caught by the law. I've heard tale they have secret entryways with passwords to get in, and once you're inside, they've got all kinds of hidden panels and quick hiding spots so they can stash their liquor in case there's a raid by the police. Still, I thought it strange that in Shady's whole establishment, I hadn't seen but one bottle of liquor, and it was sitting right out in the open. This was something to ponder. But for now, I was wasting the cool of the morning. So I wonder, if you've got a hidden compartment, why didn't he put it in there?
Well, he didn't necessarily have to hide it.
Well, no, he doesn't have to, but it's kind of cool.
Yeah, it is cool. He could maybe put something else in there.
Maybe so. I hung the dish towel on its hook and headed down the path to perdition. Oh, my goodness. I have to stop yawning. Miss Sadie's place wasn't quite as scary as the daylight. It had gone from being a full-fledged den of iniquity to a sorry excuse for a house. Grass and weeds snuck their way up through the saggy porch and all around the sides of the house, giving it the scruffy look of a week-old beard. So that is a metaphor. Comparing the porch and house to a week old beard.
Means a beard that someone hasn't shaved for a week.
Right. So highlight that. If this was a ghost house, it looked like the ghost had lost his job and all his savings along with the rest of the country. With not a breath of wind to be had, the chimes hung in silent disregard. I gauged I could be up and down those porch steps, compass in hand, in 5 seconds. That is, I could have if the compass had still been hanging there. But it was gone. Maybe she'd moved it. As I tiptoed up the rotting stairs, they creaked and groaned, cussing me for stepping on their aching backs. So, can stairs really...
No, they just stepping. Creak.
So they creak, but that's personification. So mark that.
Not hyperbole.
Personification. In the dusty window, a faded sign read, "Insights from the Beyond. Miss Sadie Redison, Medium." Mm. Do you know what a medium is?
Well, medium can mean like it's in between high and low, hot and cold.
I don't think that's what this means.
It could be middle height. It could be...
No.
No.
A medium is someone who communicates with the dead. Yes. So she says she is a medium who can communicate with the dead. There was no compass to be found outside the house. No compass to be found outside, and the house looked deserted. The screen door had a yellowed index card stuck in the white wet wire mesh that said, "Enter." I reached into my pocket, felt my 2 dimes, and tried to decide which one would give me the best answer. I chose one and flipped it. Heads, I'd go home. Tails, I'd go in. That dime was a dud. What do you think it gave her?
Tails.
Tails go in. So she's like, I'll try the other one. I switched to the other one. Tails again. Darn it all. The air in Miss Sadie's parlor was hot and thick. I thought sitting on one of those red velvety couches chock full of fringy pillows was probably akin to suffocating. Still, I had to find my compass. I took a deep breath and ventured around the room. Suddenly, the double doors of the parlor whooshed open. A large, fleshy woman stood before me in full regalia. highlight that. That's one of your vocabulary words, regalia. So full costume. Her eyes were all made up, earrings and bracelets jangling. The sign in the window said Miss Sadie was a medium. From the look of her, I'd say that was a bit wishful, but meaning she's a large woman. And the sign said she was a medium, like a size medium.
Get it?
Get it. The heavy red dress she wore brushed across the floor, tossing up dust as she hobbled to an ornate chair behind a round table. She seemed to have a bad leg and took some time squeezing herself between the arms of the chairs. Thinking she hadn't seen me, I turned to make a clean getaway.
Sit down. Sit down.
No, it's like, sit down.
Sit down,
she said, her voice thick and savory like goulash. She put her flat hands on the table.
Let us see if today the spirits are willing to speak.
Suddenly it became clear. A diviner. A medium. This woman was a fortune teller and a spirit conjurer, if you believed in that sort of thing. I stood near the front door. I'm not here for...
Silence!
She held out a hand, motioning me to the chair across from her. I sat. She slid a cigar box across the table. I almost told her no thank you. But then I saw a little slot cut into the lid. What do you think she wanted?
She wants the moolah.
Now, I don't usually have two coins to rub together.
Much like everyone else in this town.
And when I did, I was real slow to part with them. But if this was the only way to get my compass back, I guess I'd have to go along with it. I dropped in a dime. Miss Sadie peered inside the box and slid it back to me. She tapped her fingers on the table. Today is hot.
That's me.
Today it's hot. The spirits are reluctant.
I wondered if her divining abilities allowed her to see the other coin in my pocket. I might be wanton enough to risk eternal damnation on Miss Sadie's spiritualism, but I'd be hung if I'd waste another dime. So she's saying, it's hot. The spirits are reluctant, meaning she wants more money. You can tell the spirits. You can tell the spirits it ain't getting any cooler. I pushed the cigar box back. She's not going to give her any more, is she? She heaved a sigh so heavy it might have been mistaken for a dying breath.
Very well. What is it you want? Your fortune? Your future?
I squirmed, not knowing what to say. She peered at me hard and asked again.
What do you seek?
Maybe it was the way she studied me so hard that made me feel like she could see right through me to the brocade wallpaper behind me. I didn't know what made me say what I said next, and I wasn't quite sure what I meant by it. It just came out. I'm looking for my daddy. Her eyebrows went up.
I see. Now we get somewhere. Do you have a bauble?
Bauble?
A totem, trinket, something your father may have touched.
She sounds curiously like Darth Vader at times. She puckered her lips and her already... Are you okay there? And her already wrinkled face drew into more wrinkles. She probably knew darn good and well I was missing Gideon's compass and I wasn't parting with any more money. Besides, she was just an old woman full of beans anyway, so I decided to call her bluff. I pulled out the letter from Ned to Jinx that was folded in my back pocket. If Miss Sadie came up with some cock and bull story about my daddy from something that wasn't his, I'd know she was as phony as a two-headed nickel. So she's like, okay, sure, I've got a bauble from my dad. I'll give you this letter. wasn't her dad's. So if Miss Sadie tries to say it is, she's a fake.
Right.
Okay. I slid the paper over to her. Miss Sadie opened it, smoothing the yellowed paper beneath her fleshy palms. As she looked at the words, her hands began to tremble. She held them to her face and her breath came out in short, shuddering gasps. For a minute, I couldn't decide if she was crying or dying, but then figured this must be part of the divining preparations. Finally, she lifted her head and touched the letter again. Gently stroking the page with her palm, as if she was trying to draw the words into herself.
"The letter,"
she said without looking at me.
"It mentions certain mementos. You have these?"
There was something deep and old in her voice. It sounded like need. I remembered that the letter mentioned the silver dollar, fishing lure, and skeleton key. "I found them in a Lucky Bill cigar box under a loose floorboard," I answered a little too quickly, and it made me sound guilty. "There was other stuff, too," I continued, over-explaining, "an old cork and a tiny baby doll, tiny wooden baby doll, no bigger than a thimble and all painted up in bright colors. I wished I could shut myself up." After a long pause, she rested her gaze on me, puckering her lips again in thought. She seemed to be weighing whether to go on, as if deciding if I was worthy of receiving her divination.
"Very well. Place your hands on the table. I will build a bridge between the world of the living and the world of the dead."
"Oh, but my daddy is alive," I said, figuring she'd just given herself away as a fake.
"The lines between the living and the dead are not always clear."
She closed her eyes and breathed slow and deep. I closed one eye and peeked out of the other.
"It is time to reveal secrets of future and past. I see a boy from long ago,"
she began.
"He is on a train."
So far, I wasn't impressed.
"The boy, he is a stranger to manifest."
"Where is he now?" I asked, cutting to the chase.
"Silence! The spirits will not be rushed."
Miss Sadie was working up a sweat. I'd had no idea it took such effort being a spirit conjurer. I stared wide-eyed as the diviner began.
"The boy, he is tired and hungry. He must act now. He must make a leap of faith."